morning, church. My name is Phoebe and we are so glad you've joined us for church today. Missing connection with others? We've got this. We are family here. Colors and stains disappear. There is no doubt you belong. This is the family of God. No matter who you are when you walk through the door, here you're no orphan anymore. Brothers and sisters by blood, this is the family of God. Our wonderful pastoral staff is praying daily for our church family. If you need prayer, don't hesitate to reach out. We want to hear of God's goodness and blessing in your lives, so send us your testimonies. You can text, call, email, or jump onto Vantage and select forms. If you would like to give, jump onto our website, copchurch.com.au, to see our online giving options. Soon, we will be participating in communion together, so take a moment to have some juice and bread ready. Enjoy the service and have a fantastic week.
There is one thing that I know, you are faithful. Yeah, you are faithful. So I speak out your word. It has the power to change my world. You're my breakthrough. Yeah, you're my breakthrough.
Go trust.
I will trust you.
You are the never-ending.
I will trust in you. Under your wings I'm safe. Your name is like a tower. I will run to you. I will not fear the dark. Your word enlightens my way. And I know this truth. Jesus is greater. I see Jesus.
Good morning, church. Welcome to communion today. You know, when Satan first tempted Jesus to sin in the wilderness, he said, "If you are the Son of God, turn these stones into bread." And Jesus replied, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Here we see Jesus pointing to a life beyond the natural, a spiritual life, birthed, sustained, and energized by God Himself. Today I want to speak briefly with you about the way in which God brings this life to us, and that is through the blood of His Son Jesus. Growing up for me, I was not a stranger to blood. Over the years I've provided many a doctor with some stitching experience. Landing on a bedhead, a windowsill and water slide face first, dropping a log on my finger and a machete on my foot have all made for some memorable, although definitely not pleasurable, stitching experiences. And although I'm sure each of us have some stories to tell along these lines. You know, when we talk about Jesus' blood at the communion table, often there may be some macabre or gruesome thoughts associated when we consider the reality of the cross. And although I recognize the importance of the shed blood, as Hebrews 9:22 states, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission or forgiveness for sins, we can never move away from the truth that there is also life in the blood. As in the natural, so in the spiritual. To those who practice medicine, blood symbolizes life. That quality overshadows all other aspects. close to 100,000 kilometers worth of blood vessels, serve as 40 trillion cells in the human body, carrying the life-giving fluid, containing everything we need for natural life. Dr. Paul Brand and Philip Yancey wrote a powerful book called Fearfully and Wonderfully Made. They refer to Jesus' sacrifice for us, not only as the shed blood, but the shared blood. And they vividly illustrate this truth with the account of a blood transfusion to a young lady who was brought in from an accident. And as a young medical student, Paul Brand said, "I had seen a miracle, a corpse resurrected." In Ephesians 2 verse 1, Paul writes to the church saying, "And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins." How did Jesus make us alive? How did God make us alive? Not just through his shed blood, but through his shared blood. Jesus' blood brings life to us now and for eternity. Jesus said in John 6, 53 and 54, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day." Leviticus 17, 14 says, "In blood is the life of all flesh. Its blood sustains its life." And God actually forbid his people in the Old Testament from consuming animal blood. So for Jesus to come and say to the crowd, "Drink my blood and eat my flesh," it must have come as a shock to say the least. However, God was saying that the life of a sheep or cow is in its blood, and that won't benefit you. It won't bring you life. But receiving the benefits and power of the blood of Christ by faith as we partake of communion today most definitely will. But just as blood sustains our life in the natural, Jesus' blood sustains our spiritual life, giving us eternal life. Church, Jesus loves you and didn't just shed his blood for your sins, but wants you to share in the sustaining life of the blood today. Everything you need can be received by faith through the one who has the power of an endless life. His name is Jesus. When Jesus took the first communion service on the night before giving his blood, the blood transfusion if you like, he took the wine and said, "Drink from it, all of you." The blood was not just poured out on the altar in heaven for our sin, but also to be taken in, sustaining every moment of our lives. To be honest, growing up, I didn't walk around bursting with gratitude about my natural blood, mostly because of ignorance. In the same way, you might not be aware of the power of Jesus' blood at work on your behalf. But after taking a fresh look today at the wonder of Christ's shed blood, let's take this opportunity to lift up our praise and thanks and to continue to draw by faith on the power of Jesus' body and blood around the communion table. So let's just take the bread. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your precious body that was broken for us, Lord God. We do this in remembrance of you and receive, Lord, your benefits, Lord. And Lord, we thank you that there is life in the blood, Lord. And I just pray for your saints today, that life, Lord God, would course through every fiber of their being, Lord God. And we thank you that this life, Lord, is for eternity. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen. Well, God bless you, saints. Have a great day.
Pastor Claude recently read a great testimony. There has been a significant new interest in the gospel around the world. With prayer rising across the nations, there appears to have been a shift in the spiritual atmosphere. For example, in the UK, there has been a surge of interest in prayer and online church services, with a survey finding that a third of young people have watched an online church service. Fascinatingly, one in five of those who've watched church online have never gone to any church service before in their lives. Meanwhile, in the US, 22% of non-Christians have started reading their Bibles since the crisis began. In fact, some secular stores have been running out of Bibles, and Bible sales across the nation are up between 40 to 160%. This is my testimony.
Well, good morning. You know, I'm so excited because yesterday I had an incredible answer to prayer. It was an answer to prayer for somebody else, not for me. And it just caused my heart to burst with joy because I know that I was so specific in my prayer request for a person that it had to be the God that answered it, and answered it so quickly. I remember some years ago I was traveling overseas, and I was in the lounge waiting to depart from another country, and I was talking to a man of another faith, a minister of another faith, not the Christian faith. And so I began to ask him questions. Does your God answer prayer? And being very polite, not in any way being aggressive, but being respectful. And he said, yes. And I said, can you give me some specific illustrations? And he thought for a moment, said, no, I can't, but I know he does. And so in our conversation, I began to ask him about, do you at times when you're praying have a sense of God's presence? Are you aware of God's presence? Because you see, the presence of God does manifest. The Spirit of God's presence does manifest. And I've been saying in the last couple of weeks that, you know, that if you read Genesis 1 verse 2, that that when darkness was covering the earth, the Spirit of the Lord was hovering. And that means that because of his presence, God was about to speak, and the Spirit of God went into action. And so I said, do you ever sense God's presence, his intangible presence, when God makes himself real to you? And he said, no, but I believe he's with me. For the answer to that question is me. I'm aware very much at different times of his manifesting presence. And clearly I've had unbelievable numbers of illustrations that God has answered my prayers. And it is when I look into the scriptures, I want to talk about that to you today, because the Bible says these words, and this is what I was doing yesterday in Psalm 47 verse 1. Clap your hands, all you people, and shout unto God with a voice of triumph. And I begin to shout and to give him glory, as I know that God had so wonderfully answered my prayers. It makes me consider what, when you're reading the scriptures, when the children of Israel, in their obedience to God, in conquering the city of Jericho, they marched around it once for six days, and on the seventh day, seven times. And when the trumpet sounded, the people began to shout, and the walls came down. I really do believe, as I look into the scriptures, and one of my favorites is in Romans 15, verse 13, where it says, now the God of hope, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. That scripture, it was quickened to my heart, and I haven't forgotten those scriptures that God quickened to my heart. But notice that because he wants to fill us with all joy and peace in believing, that we may abound with that confident expectation of good. I know as I look into the scriptures, it is that it's faith that pleases God, and it's faith that honors God. And Jesus said, you believe in God, in John 14, then believe also in me. And Jesus is the very author and the very perfecter of our faith. And when you put your faith, truly put your faith, and you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll find, because with real faith in trusting in him, joy and peace will be your experience. When I consider this this life of faith, Paul said, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And I find that faith can come to us in many ways. And I suppose that from the scriptures, I understand that faith, it comes by hearing and understanding the Word of God. And as you read the Word of God, God knows where it is in your daily devotional. God knows where you are in reading the scriptures, that you will find that God will quicken his word to your heart and to your life. You know, we were reading today with my staff here at the Cathedral of Praise, and we were reading the account of Jesus standing in his home church and reading the scriptures. They gave him the book to read. You know, it wasn't a book like we have, it was a scroll. And he found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me. And he goes on to say many reasons for why that anointing is upon his life. And there is a reason for that anointing that God has given to you that is upon your life. It's just not to make you feel good or to give the surety of salvation, but it is for the benefits of others. And he finishes with to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. If you go back to Isaiah 61, where he is reading from that passage of scripture, you would understand that that if you keep reading that verse to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, it says that the days of vengeance may be fulfilled. This is not the day of God's vengeance. This is the day of God's grace. There is coming such a day before he returns to the earth, before he establishes his kingdom. But before the days of vengeance, you will find that he's going to take his church out. There's going to be a catching away, because he's not appointed us unto wrath, but to obtain salvation. And so it is that God in his mercy and his grace, and this is a day of grace that we are living in. And you need to know that grace flows to your heart and to your life because you dare to believe who Jesus is. And he is the Son of the living God. The scripture tells us this. Please, I know I keep emphasizing this, but it's so important that you know when you read the scriptures. Listen to this. These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the anointed, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. There is authority and there is power when you call upon the name of Jesus. Really call out to him. You can experience that life and you can experience that joy and peace in believing in him. So faith comes, you know, in that true sense by hearing and understanding the word of God. But also faith can be imparted to us. And I know I have so many dear friends in the world, but there are those who I just recognize that the hand of God is upon them, and I like to contact with them and talk with them. At the moment, it's Skyping, FaceTiming, this way, or on the phone, because I want to hear their voice. And the scripture talks about that faith can be imparted. And it is in the privilege that I have in associating with these wonderful men, and that I find that when I'm talking to them, after being with them, that there's become an impartation of faith. Listen, I think, to what Paul wrote to Timothy, son in the faith. He says these words, if I can find it, in 5 and 6. I think it's in 1 Timothy. He's talking about Timothy, and he says, I can't find it. I thought I did have the reference. 1 Timothy, sorry. Let me just check with you on this, because I don't want to give you the wrong reference. He says this: when I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I'm persuaded also in you. I think that faith can be imparted by associating with men and women of faith, and we can catch it. And it is as we hear their words, we catch their words of faith. Because you see, words are language. Language is truth carriers. And it is that Jesus said, my words are spirit and my words are life. And when men and women who have had an encounter with God and they know him and they've experienced his grace and the evidence of his hand upon their life and the fruitfulness of what I have seen, I know that as they're speaking, I'm listening to catch the words that are full of faith. Because if I catch the words that are full of faith, then those words can also, I can begin to declare. And remember, in catching the words of faith and speaking the words of faith and believing, the Bible says God will fill us with all joy and peace in believing. Somebody once wrote that, you know, when I read the word of God, the facts are to be believed. The commands are to be obeyed. But remember, you're in the old new covenant, not in the old. And the promises are to be enjoyed. As I look into the word of God, I believe that God wants you to believe the facts. God wants you to obey the commands. And he said, my commandments are not grievous. They're not burdensome. They're not irksome. He said, my yoke is easy. My burden is light. Look, he said, my promises, I want you to enjoy them. When the scripture said, and I was just so bursting with joy yesterday as God had answered my prayer, I was so full of thanksgiving for this person that I've been praying for, that the answer had come specifically. It caused me to rejoice and celebrate in his goodness. I felt like promises were tumbling out of heaven onto the throne of grace, from the throne of grace onto people's lives. I begin to say to people, quick, receive the promises, quick. The promises are falling. Catch them, catch them, catch the promises, because God is just moving wonderfully by his Spirit. And we need to catch the promises of God. And as we do catch the promises of God by the declaration of our faith in him, and we need to shout to the Lord for the voice of triumph. But God promises to give you and me the victory. You know, the Bible says that God fill you with all joy and peace in believing. And in believing, the scripture says, a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. And when we consider this, you say, but Pastor, you know, there are times that I'm going through trials. Of course, I understand that. We don't live in a perfect world. And we live in a world of mortality. But Jesus said these words, and you need to hear them in John 16, verse 33. In the world, you'll have tribulation. You'll have trials. But he said, cheer up, for I have overcome the world. When I read that scripture, when he says, cheer up, for I have overcome the world, I like to put in brackets after that. These are my words, for me. He's overcome the world for me. He's overcome the world for you. And so he wants us to cheer up. So in believing with him, he'll give us joy and peace. And because he has overcome the world. And the Bible says, this is the victory that overcomes the world. But he that believeth that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And so when I look into the scriptures, my heart rejoices, because thanks be to God that gives us the victory. He overcame the world, and he's going to give you the victory. And the word of God makes it clear again that we should shout to the Lord with a voice of triumph. When I look into his wonderful promises, and I know and understand that in the journey that we are on, God, in trusting in him and believing in him, develops our character. I remember years ago when I was going through one of my most severe trials, that the word of the Lord came into my heart. It was a word that that again from the scripture. You know, the scriptures are it's a living book. The Bible says the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. This is the Logos. But when God quickens it to you personally, it's the Rhema. And I remember that as I was going through a physical trial, something from my very depth of my spirit said, I'm not finished. And I remember as I went to the scriptures, and the Lord in John chapter 4 was there waiting for the disciples to bring him some food. A woman came to draw water from the well. And after conversing with her, she left and went back into the city to tell people, a man. She said, come see a man. And it was that while she was away, the disciples came and said, Lord, eat. And he said, I've got meat to eat that you know not of, and to finish the work that he has given me. And I realized at that time in that trial, I was not finished. I remember Jesus said, it is finished. We'll get to that in a minute. But also Paul said, and when he come to the end of his time, he said, I've finished my course. I've kept the faith, and there's later for me a crown of righteousness. God has a purpose, as the anointing is for a purpose, and God has a purpose for you being here, that you might convey your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, for he is the resurrection and the life. And as I look into the scripture, I remember in that journey that it was in as I was recovering and believing and trusting in him daily, that I went from strength to strength. I found in Psalm 5, just again, as I was reading the word, you know, God knows where you are in the scriptures. If you've got a pattern of reading the word, God can quicken the word of God to your heart right where you are. And in Psalm 5, verse 11 and 12, these verses just touch my lips. Let all those rejoice who put their trust in you. Let them ever shout for joy because you defend them. Let those who love your name be joyful in you. For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous, and you will and with favor you will surround him as with a shield. Wow. I tell you, when I read that scriptures many years ago, as I was holding on to the word of the Lord, believing that I wasn't finished, there was a work that he still had for me to do. And I thank God that he's proven to be faithful to his word. And I've found that his promises are to be enjoyed. And I've found that his commandments are to be obeyed. And I believe that the facts that I read in the scripture are to be believed. It releases faith toward him and favor toward me. When I consider the scriptures, we know in Genesis 22 verse 5, it was the first time the word, the law of first mention was, the word worship was first mentioned. And in Matthew 22 verse 5, you know the account if you know the scriptures, but if you don't, let me just say that the Lord had promised Abraham a son through through the womb of his wife Sarah. And it so happened that that Sarah had died, and the Lord had spoken to Abraham that he was to offer his son as a living sacrifice. Now, God wouldn't expect that of you today. Please, you've got to understand the heathen customs of that day. But God was testing him, and this was a type of picture that the time would come that God would give his son as a sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. And as he took and found the place where God wanted him to offer his son Isaac, he said to his servants who were with him, "You just wait here. I and the lad will go yonder, listen to this, and worship, and will come again." Because you see, the promises of God to Abraham were related to Isaac, the son of promise. So Abraham had to believe that God would raise him from the dead. And there are three ingredients to faith that is that making faith so palatable. You know, my wife is a fabulous cook. I hope your wife is too. I bet your mother is, but the reality is that she is. And but I know to make a nice meal, there are certain ingredients. I know to make a nice dessert, there are certain ingredients. The three ingredients to faith are obedience, attitude, and expectation. Remember, there's an obedience, acting on the word, and joyfully responding to what he's asking you to do, and with an expectation. The scripture says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I'm telling you, joy will come into your heart and peace will come into your heart many times before you have the answer. But it's that joy is your strength, and it's that joy that gives you a merry heart. And it's that peace that keeps you calm in the storm. And God, in his appointed time, will deliver. God, in his appointed time, will bring you through. Because he's for you. He loves you. And people see us going through valleys, and they see us coming out of the valleys, and they start to know and understand in this mortal life and this world that we are living in that God cares for us. And there's a development of our character in our lives as we're going through those necessary trials. As I look into the Word of God, I really do believe the scripture says in Isaiah 53. Maybe I can just turn to there for a moment, because I sense that I need to read this to you in Isaiah 53, because the Bible says that who have believed, or to whom will the arm of the Lord be made bare? Who has believed the report of the Lord? Listen to this. Who has believed our report? To whom is the arm of the Lord made bare? Do you know, God will make himself known to you if you believe the facts and obey the commands and enjoy the promises. Because it is that God is so for you that I can't emphasize this enough. If he wasn't for us, he would never have sent his son. Do you realize that as I look into the scripture, to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? I mean, when Jesus was on the cross at the end of it, he said, "It's done, it's finished." And what was it that he finished? He paid the price for humanity's salvation. He paid the price that now his arm could be revealed, his strength could be revealed to you, and his strength could be revealed to you, because he saved you for a purpose, that his strength might be revealed to you and through you, that others would dare to believe, because you have believed. This last couple of weeks, we've sent our financial support to our missionaries in Israel and in India. And I want you to know that we're praying for people in other parts of the world in this time of lockdown. And it is that when people came to Jesus, I find that he didn't turn any of them away. He said, "All that he said, anybody that comes to me, he won't turn them aside." you might say, a question was asked of me the other night in the question answers, can you get too far away from God that there's no chance of coming back? I mean, there's obviously in the scriptures we can consider Pharaoh when he hardened his heart seven times, but eventually God hardened his heart the last three times. There is a point of no return, but that's very rare. And that's not you, if you're listening to me. And I want you to understand that a man came to Jesus in Mark chapter 9. He said, can you? And Jesus said, can you? In other words, this man said, if you can do anything, in Mark 9 verse 23, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said, can you? It's not about what he can, it's what you can. Jesus wants to know what you can. Is it hard to believe in him? When I look at the scriptures and consider what he has done, is it hard to believe in him? Because he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I know sometimes it might be hard to believe because of religious traditions. And the Bible tells us that in Mark chapter 7. And religious conditions, you've got to be careful about religious traditions. If you have a tradition of doing something, you know, we have traditions in our church of having communion. But I taught my children what these traditions were about, what they meant. That is, we eat the bread and drink the blood, remembering the sacrifice that our Lord Jesus Christ made for us so that we could be whole, that we could be well, that we could fulfill our purpose and our destiny that he has for us. God has us here for a purpose, and God has a purpose for your life. But I find in this passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 7, listen to this. Jesus said to this, these people honor me with their lips and their heart is far from, and in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. And laying aside the commandments of God, they hold to the traditions of men. And the scripture goes on to say how serious this is. I mean, people just reject the commandments of God. I think there is a scripture, making the word of God of no effect through your traditions, which you've handed down, and many such things as you do. Watch religious traditions that say, well, God is not doing what he did back there in the book of Acts. God is doing what he did back there in the book of Acts. This is the day of grace. This is the acceptable year of the Lord. This is the acceptable time that you can find acceptance with him. You have a voice. Why don't you lift your voice to him? Why don't you call upon his name? Do you remember the story in Mark chapter 9? In Mark chapter 9, Mark chapter 10, there was a man by the name of Bartimaeus. He was a blind man. And the scripture says that he heard that Jesus of Nazareth, he was by the wayside begging, and he heard that Jesus of Nazareth was passing by, and he began to cry out, Son of David, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy upon you. He only heard. He was blind. He hadn't seen any of the miracles and the things that Jesus did. But he heard about him, and he wanted his circumstances to change. He wanted his conditions to change. And he began to cry out, Son of David, have mercy upon me. And many warned him to be quiet. Hush, 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 hush. I remember years ago I had a visiting ministry in my church. And this man was preaching the gospel. And one of our brothers was severely afflicted with some sort of genuinely physical pain. And he couldn't wait to the end of the service. And he walked out in front of the preacher. And I was sitting on the platform at that time. And he said to the preacher out loud, what about me? What about me? And the preacher looked at him and said, yeah, what about him? And he laid his hands on him. You know, God delivered him and healed him that morning. Because there was a cry within his heart. You need to lift your voice to God. And here the scripture says in this, I could tell you that man's name. I know what I'm talking about is true. And so it was that as they told Bartimaeus to be quiet, he cried out all the more. And he said, Son of David, he recognized that Jesus was the anointed, that Jesus was the Messiah. Have mercy on me. You know, God is rich in mercy. And as I look at the scriptures, the Bible says, and Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they said to the blind man who was trying to tell him to be quiet, he's calling for you. He's calling for you. Cheer up. As if, so he threw aside his garments and rose. You read about this in Mark 10. And Jesus said, what do you want me to do for you? And have you imagined? What do you want me to do for you? I mean, that's a good question. That is a good question. What it is that you want him to do. You've got to be specific about your faith. You've got to be specific about when you come to him. And he said, Lord, I want to receive my sight. And he said, go your way. Your faith has made you well. Faith has a voice. Faith has a voice. And we need to lift our voice, shout unto God with a voice of triumph. We need to lift up our voice to him. Who will believe the report of the Lord? To whom is the arm of the Lord made bare? To those who will believe the report of the Lord. I know what the scripture says in Hosea 14:2. The scripture says in Isaiah 14:2, come with words. You know, the Bible says we should enter into his gates with thanksgiving and come into his courts with praise, declaring and saying that this is the day that the Lord hath made. What is it? This proclaim the day of the Lord. They proclaim the year of the Lord. Proclaim the goodness of the Lord. Proclaim the mercy of the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going to keep proclaiming it. And the scripture says you come with words. Language is a truth carrier. You know, it's the truth when I confess my sins. Yes, it is. And the Bible says he's faithful and just to forgive me for my sins and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. The confession of faith is a confession of truth because it's not about your who you are, about who he is. And the scripture says in Romans 10, if you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, language is a truth carrier. You don't have to confess you. You have to confess him. The very basis of our confession in the Lord Jesus Christ is because of the atonement that he made for us. And you know, there could be, if there was no atonement, there could be no grace. When I look into the scriptures, I wonder if you understand this, that firstly, atonement speaks of judgment, but then is followed up with grace. The Lord Jesus, if you would understand this, God saves and he saves within the boundaries of his own justice because of the restitution for the sinner that he made at Calvary. He saves within the boundaries of his own justice. He paid the penalty for our sin. And in paying the penalty for our sin, he's not condemning us. He's wanting us to come to him and believe in him and to lift up our voice to him. God wants to move on your heart and move into your situation and move upon your circumstances and bring deliverance and wholeness and salvation. For he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. When I look into the scriptures, I always see this pattern. There was judgment and then salvation. What about the children of Israel? Before they could be released from Egypt, there was judgment and then salvation. It was that we find in the scriptures that there is redemption and propitiation and reconciliation because of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember that. There was, in that true sense of the word, him working for you on your behalf. I mean, I've been rejoicing yesterday and today because of the answer to prayer, and I'm expecting more answers to prayer. I lift up my voice to him. I confess who he is. And remember, the facts are to be believed, and the commandments are to be obeyed. And his commandments are not grievous and are not burdensome. And what? Not his commandments, his promises are to be enjoyed. And he wants to bring about the manifestation of his promises into your life. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I would call out, and I would continue to call out. You say, I've called out once and nothing happened. Well, Bartimaeus continued to call out, Son of David, have mercy upon me. Jesus of Nazareth, Son of David, have mercy upon me. And he called out, and he called out, and the Lord said, bid him become. What do you want? I mean, you have to be clearly clarity why you're coming to him. Do you want to win the lotto? That's nonsense. That's nonsense. What is it that you want that's going to affect you and fill your life with purpose and meaning? It's your relationship with Jesus and doing his will. I want to pray for you today because God is for you and not against you. And remember, the facts are to be believed and the commandments are to be obeyed. And I'm not talking about the old covenant. I'm talking about the new covenant. And the promises, his promises, are to be enjoyed. And there's so many wonderful, exceeding great and precious promises. Look, let me give you promises. Do you believe that God can bless you in this time materially? Well, I look into the scriptures. Let me just read this to you. I feel to do this in the Spirit. The scripture tells us this. I've got to find this passage of scripture. He said, Paul is writing to the church of Philippi. And he said, when I departed from Macedonia, no church, listen to this, shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. I mean, the word of God talks about giving and receiving. And then he says, you said something to help me in my need. And he said, indeed, I have all and abound and I'm full. Having received from Aphrodites the things sent from you as a sweet smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, well pleasing to God. And it is that as they begin to help Paul in his ministry, the scripture says this, and he said, and my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. And my God shall supply all your need. God is interested in you. He's not only interested in you spiritually, he's interested in you and your physical well-being, and he's interested in you materially. God is interested in you, and he cares about you, and he loves you. So it's important that you understand, I'm going to say it again, the facts are to be believed, and the commandments are to be obeyed. Oh, his burden, his yoke is easy. His promises are not irksome. Oh, it just releases the favor of God, and his promises are to be enjoyed. God is for you. I know he is, because he's for me. I was thinking the other day about the grace of God in my life, and I began to reflect how it was that I came to believe in Christ. And I thought to myself, Lord, if you were so merciful to me and revealed yourself and made yourself known to me, because I wasn't a Christian. I wasn't raised in a Christian home. I remember some years ago, I was at a function, and the Governor General of Australia was there, St. Ninian Stephen. He's probably passed on now. But as I was sitting at a table with him and enjoying his company, he asked me about my faith. And so I began to share with him. He wanted to know why I became a minister. And so I began to share with him, but I didn't realize that every time I was interjecting this statement when I became a Christian. And I remember he cleaned his pipe. Of course, he was a High Court judge. He was a Queen's Counsel. He sat on the war crimes tribunal in the Netherlands many years ago. And so he was a very astute, well-learned, educated man, listening to every word. And he said, you keep using this phrase, when I became a Christian. And he said, what do you mean? And I shared with him about how I was converted to Christ. I talked about the transformation in my life. And he said to me when we were finished, most religious men don't want to talk about these things, but you do. This has been a most rewarding evening. I was thinking about how I came to Christ. And I was thinking about this, and I'm thinking, Lord, you reach my heart in the unique with you, and you can do the same with them or in any other method that you want to use. But I pray in the name of Jesus that if you lift your voice, you'll have a shout of faith. You'll have a shout of triumph, because God is for you and not against you. And glory to God. I'm believing that his power and his presence will manifest in your life and answer your prayers. Let me just pray for you today. Father, in the name of Jesus, you know who's listening to us out there, and I pray that your word will go forth with power. In the name of Jesus, receive that release. In the name of Jesus, let there come a revelation. In the name of Jesus, let there be provision. In the name of Jesus, for you are the God that works wonders. And you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. May we pray the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit communing with your children today and those who are outside the kingdom of God, that they might come in and join us in this walk of faith because of his amazing grace. God bless you all today. Great to be with you. Lift up your voice. Have a shout of triumph unto God. For thanks be to God that gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.